Thank you all for joining us this afternoon. For those of you I've not yet had the pleasure to meet, I'm Courtney Curry, and I work in the Division of Philanthropy at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Before we begin our program, I would like to share some brief housekeeping notes. First, your camera and microphone are automatically turned off to ensure everyone can hear the program. Second, we encourage your questions today, and we welcome you to type questions within the Q&A icon at the bottom panel of your Zoom screen. Please feel free to add your questions throughout the program, and we look forward to addressing as many as possible after we hear from our speakers. Lastly, please note that this session is being recorded, and the recording will be shared with you after the event. Now, I'm delighted to introduce today's topic, an insider look at the PROMISE study. Prevention and early detection efforts are a key part of the Dana-Farber campaign. Our ambitious, multi-year, $2 billion fundraising effort to prevent, treat, and defy cancer by accelerating revolutionary science, extraordinary care, and exceptional expertise. Dana-Farber has been a leader in early detection and prevention for decades. Our scientists were the first to identify abnormalities in certain inherited genes that explained why some families had a pattern of cancer across generations. We have studied hundreds of genetic mutations that can cause an array of adult and pediatric cancers. And our researchers have made discoveries that could lead to much needed early detection and screening methods for blood cancers, like the PROMISE study Dr. Ghobrial will highlight today. But to significantly reduce the burden of cancer, we need to enhance our ability to detect the earliest signs that cancers are likely to develop and prevent them from doing so. Research in this area holds a particularly strong promise for those at high risk of developing blood cancers. Today, widespread screening is not conducted for blood cancers and their precursor conditions, even though it is easy to detect these conditions from a blood sample. Moreover, the standard of care for a patient diagnosed with a precursor condition is to watch and wait until the condition develops into a full-blown cancer. Dr. Irene Ghobrial is challenging this paradigm. She is pioneering a new one with the aim of stopping cancers before they start. Dr. Ghobrial is the founding and current director for the Center for Prevention of Progression of Blood Cancers, director of translational research in multiple myeloma, and Levine Family Chair for Preventative Cancer Therapies at Dana-Farber. I work closely with Dr. Ghobrial and the donors who partner with us, and I'm delighted so many of you could join us today. I'm also delighted many who support other areas of research at Dana-Farber and who volunteer in a variety of ways could join us. Thank you for partnering with us to push the frontier of cancer research and care forward. We are also very grateful to have Robert Adamson, a patient with smoldering myeloma, joining us today to talk a bit about what this trial means to him. It's now my pleasure to pass the microphone over to Dr. Ghobrial.
Thank you so much, Courtney, and thank you everyone who is joining us today live or hopefully in the future on the video stream. And I just want to thank again, Robert, and everyone who's here today, because it's truly from the help that everyone gives us, whether it's through the fundraising or through being part of the studies or giving us ideas. This is how Dana-Farber has developed. It's truly a community effort. It's really a work that we do with everyone, and it's not just the work that scientists or physicians do alone. So I just want to echo what Courtney said, and thank you so much for this. And as I think of the fundraising program that Dana-Farber started, it is an ambitious program, but we want to make a difference. We want to change the way we think of cancer. And I think there is no better way to change completely the way we think of cancer other than early detection and early prevention. Because if we think about it, we can make a difference in curing the disease early before it even starts showing symptoms. And I think that's where Dana-Farber can really excel. And it's through development of new technologies. It's through development of new initiatives that we're doing, as you will see now from the PROMISE study and beyond. But it's also the clinical care that we give. The true difference that we have as physician scientists is we understand the science, but we understand the care for patients, and we can deliver on that. So with that, maybe what I'll do is I'll show you some of the work we've done on the PROMISE study and what we're hoping to do in the bigger picture, but also take that opportunity to have a discussion, an open discussion with many of you, and answer some of the questions. And the first idea that why we started the Center for Prevention of Progression and why do we care is that many cancers start with an early precancerous condition, with an early asymptomatic condition. Yet when you think about it, almost every other cancer center, almost every other industry, companies, they're working on developing drugs and working on developing understandings of how to treat metastatic disease, how to treat cancer when it already developed, how to make a difference later on in relapsed refractory stages. And yet, if you think about it, when we are diagnosed with cancer, the first thing we have is the symptoms. We go to a cancer center because someone developed pain or a lump or something, and that brings us to the attention of a primary care doctor. Then we go to the cancer center and get the care because we were diagnosed with the cancer after we had symptoms. But what if you change completely this way of thinking? What if we detect it early? And I think of it more like a surveillance. We don't wait for someone to attack us in our country and then we start attacking them back. We are already watching and making sure that no one comes and attack us. And this is what we want to do with cancer. I want to be surveilling it and I want to detect it early before it starts causing symptoms to me. And by completely changing the way we think of cancer detection, we can actually cure the cancer by early diagnosis and early interventions before we even have symptoms, before we even start having the back pain, the bone pain, or the lump. And this is true for every cancer, but very much true for blood cancers like multiple myeloma. Next slide. So I'll take you through that every cancer does have a precancerous condition. And this is very well known, but we don't diagnose them early because we don't have too many cancer screening programs. And I think this is another area now with the novelties that we have now, with the new technologies that we have, we can change the way we can screen and detect early our cancers. So think of cervical cancers, we do pap smears, breast cancer, we do mammography. But multiple myeloma is a blood cancer. And in fact, you can diagnose it early with just a blood test, with a serum protein electrophoresis, or as I'll show you, with something even more sensitive now, we call it mass spectrometry. So it's a much better way of detection. And as you can see here in the slide, almost every cancer you can diagnose early, but myeloma and other blood cancers, we have the actual tools to diagnose them early and potentially make a difference in the treatment of those patients. Next slide. So why did we start the PROMISE study? And I can tell you that over the last 5 to 6 years, we said, let's see patients early who have this early monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, early smoldering myeloma, and let's not wait for people to have the end organ damage. Let's not wait for anyone to have the fractures or kidney disease. Yet when I saw many people who were diagnosed incidentally because someone decided to check their M spike or their monoclonal protein, or someone decided to check what's going on with them when they had mild anemia, I said that this is just pure chance that we're finding them early. And what is more important is, can we screen for it? And we screen for the people who have a high risk of developing it. So we don't have to screen the whole population, but we can screen people at risk so that we make sure that we detect it early. And by doing that, we can intervene and prevent myeloma from happening. Next slide. And if you think about it, MGUS, or the precursor of multiple myeloma, is a very common disease. In fact, as we get older, and all of us hopefully will get older and older, we are at risk of developing MGUS, and it increases with age. But it also increases much more in certain populations. People who have a family history of blood cancer, so if you have a relative with blood cancer, you have a 2 to 3 times higher chance of developing MGUS or multiple myeloma, as well as people of African American or African origin. And again, we don't know why, but 2 to 3 times higher in the Black community. And we still want to understand, why are you at risk and what can we do to prevent that risk? And if you think about it, it's about 3 to 5% of the population over the age of 50, and it goes up to almost 10% as we get older. Now, that's a lot of people walking around with an asymptomatic condition of MGUS, but they have a high chance of developing multiple myeloma. And if we think about it, every single myeloma case who is diagnosed today must have had a precursor, must have had an MGUS or a smoldering myeloma. So instead of waiting for you to have the bone pain or the fracture and suddenly get diagnosed with myeloma and try to figure out what is the best treatment, what can I do today to save my life or my relative's life? Why not reverse it? Why not diagnose it early, especially if you're at risk, and intervene early before you ever develop this symptom? Next slide. And some of you will tell me, well, there are so many cases of MGUS, but how about actually developing myeloma? The chances of going from MGUS to myeloma is very low. It's only 1% chance per year. But the chance of going from smoldering myeloma, which is the next stage of precursor, to active myeloma is 10% per year. And in some people, it's 50% chance in 2 years. That's a 50% chance of getting a fracture or kidney failure or anemia in 2 years. And I can tell you, I see so many people, young or old, who really don't want to take that flip of a coin, that chance of I'm going to have an end organ damage, a fracture in the next 2 years. And what can I do to make sure that I prevent that and never develop the disease itself? Next slide. And I usually use the way of thinking as in breast cancer. We know that for breast cancer, we do mammography because cancer screening saves lives and because we can diagnose it early. And when you diagnose it early, you never tell a woman, I know you have an early DCIS, but you're asymptomatic and you're doing fine. Why don't we wait and leave you alone until you have metastatic disease, until you have fractures in your bones, and then I treat you? You would think that that would be crazy. Yet that's what we're doing with myeloma to date. We're not screening for it. And now finally, the PROMISE study is changing that. We are hoping to make it standard of care that you screen for multiple myeloma because we can save lives with it. And when we diagnose MGUS and smoldering myeloma, if you go to many other cancer centers or to any other physician, they might tell you, oh, watch and wait, or watch and worry, as we call it, until you have fractures and anemia and kidney failure, and then we treat you, what we call CRAB criteria. That's the standard of care, and that should not be the standard of care. Just like in breast cancer, you would think it's crazy to wait. We're still waiting in multiple myeloma, and that does not make any sense to us. So we really need to change that way of thinking. Next slide. So the PROMISE study, what we wanted to do is we ask for the first time, can we screen in the United States for people who are at risk of myeloma? Can we screen for MGUS? And when we detected in those people, we asked the question, well, why do you have MGUS and your relative or someone else does not have it? What is different between you, germline, and understanding what is in this family that puts them at risk? We're also asking what puts you at risk of developing multiple myeloma in the future. And instead of using clinical markers only, like your monoclonal protein, your bone marrow percentage, now we're thinking, can we use genomics? Can we use next generation sequencing? Can we use liquid biopsies from your peripheral blood? Can we use all of these new technologies that we have in our hands to enhance the way we think of how to give you a better prognosis, how to give you a better sense of when you will develop myeloma, and then also develop new therapies to prevent myeloma, immunotherapy, vaccines, all of these things, so that in the future, no one will ever develop myeloma in their lifetime. Next slide. And this is the PROMISE study that we started it a few years ago with the help of Stand Up to Cancer and many other institutions and foundations. And as you can see here, we have a big initiative. We're screening 30,000 individuals. We expect to have 10% prevalence, meaning 10% of the people we screen have truly MGUS. And we're checking what happens in those people, what causes them to develop MGUS. Why are they at risk, whether they have a family member or they're African-American? What are the immune system changes that happen in them? And can we alter those? Can we prevent all of this by developing new immunotherapies and new targeted therapies? So in one hand, we develop new biomarkers so that we can stratify patients and we can tell you if you're at risk of developing myeloma or not. And in the other hand, can we develop therapy to prevent it if you're at risk so that we do not wait for you to develop myeloma? Next slide. And the eligibility, as you can see here, it's either you are of age 40 to 75, although we're changing that and we're starting to actually allow people who are younger and allowing people, everyone at any age, as long as you're 30 and above. But it's either you're African-American or you have a first degree relative of blood cancer. And then if you have multiple family members with blood cancer, we're allowing it at age 18 or above, because we know that this family has a very high risk. And I can tell you, we've seen people who have a brother with MGUS, sister with myeloma, a cousin with lymphoma. We want to understand why you're at such a high risk and how can we determine the risk in the future by detecting certain genes that put the whole family at risk and potentially preventing that early for this family. Next slide. Now, PROMISE study was an idea that instead of having people come to us, we're going to them. We're allowing it to be direct to patient access. We're allowing everyone to sign up wherever they are. It's on your phone, it's on your tablet. You can sign up. You do not need a physician to co-sign with you. Just sign up, accept the terms, and we send you a kit and you go anywhere, Quest Diagnostic or any local lab, and get your blood drawn. And we would call you if you have an early precursor condition. I call almost everyone and tell them what's going on, what does it mean for them. I'm happy to see you, whether virtually or in person, and we follow up with those participants. And if you're negative, we rescreen you back again in 3 years because we know that some people will still develop it after rechecking them. Next slide. Now, some people will tell me, well, I already have MGUS and smoldering myeloma. Do I enroll on the PROMISE study? And the answer is no. We have two sister studies. The sister study is PCRowd or Pangea, which is the larger effort. And PCRowd is precursor crowd. And instead of crowdsourcing for money, we're crowdsourcing for patients. And the whole idea was anyone who has MGUS, anyone who has smoldering myeloma, nationwide, even international now, sign up to it. Again, it's online. You can sign your consent. It's direct to patient access. And again, we get your blood and your sample, and we follow you to see if you're going to progress, what is the cause for this, and how can we prevent it. And we have over 3,000 participants who joined us within the first few years, and we've been tracking those people and trying to see how can we prevent myeloma. All of the discoveries we're doing it through all of the help of our patients, because you're giving us samples, you're giving us the effort. So it's truly a community effort. We are understanding how to prevent myeloma through the patients who are giving us their samples and their bone marrow biopsy so that we can develop better methods to prevent the disease from progressing. Next slide. Now, this is just a short video to tell you a little bit about the PROMISE study, but I think it's a video that really reflects the enthusiasm of every participant, the excitement that every person says, why do they want to be part of this PROMISE study? Why does it matter for them, but also for their family members? So I hope you enjoy this few minutes.
I promise to help everyone who's at risk of myeloma, diagnosing it early and never having it happen.
I promise to encourage folks to get an early diagnosis.
I promise to give myself and my community a fighting chance.
I promise to continue empowering myself and others.
I promise to not stop fighting to advance our understanding of myeloma.
My promise is to continue to support my sister, to support my family, and to support science.
I promise to foster hope by encouraging people to participate in the PROMISE study.
I promise to never give up.
So with that, I want to thank everyone. I really want to thank, of course, our founders and Stand Up to Cancer, MMRF, AMRF, of course, above all, Dana-Farber, and the support of every patient and every one of you who helps us, because it truly matters a lot that we work together to make this happen. So thank you so much for your contribution and for your effort with us. With that, I'll stop and ask Robert to join me. Robert is, colleague, a patient, but also someone who gives me feedback to tell me about what we do in our efforts. As a PCRowd participant, he really helps me understand better as a patient advocate what else we can do. So Robert, please tell me what you think of the PCRowd study and What would you like to tell everyone about your contribution in this study?
Well, thank you, Dr. Ghobrial, and thanks for inviting me. I'm new to this effort. I recently enrolled in PCROWD, and I want to say that it's very easy to do so. You can go online. You don't need a physician. You can just answer a few questions. I was determined to be eligible, and I'm officially in. I'm particularly happy to be a part of this effort to increase awareness. I feel like patients like me can help to save lives, actually, because this is very important work, as you've highlighted in your presentation, and can result in some information that will do just that, keep people from getting this serious blood disorder. So I feel like I'm really a part of something big, and I'm happy to be a part.
Well, thank you. And I guess part of that is the journey through Dana-Farber, being a patient at Dana-Farber. Do you want to give me more sense of how is the whole journey, basically?
Right. When I was asked to be a patient advocate, it was easy for me, because I've got to say that Dana-Farber, you, Dr. Ghobrial, and everyone that I've come in contact with has a way of putting you at ease. Obviously, walking into the door of Dana-Farber, you wouldn't be walking in unless you had an issue of concern or a battle that you're dealing with. And so I always laugh when they take my blood pressure. I said, do you really want to take my blood pressure right now? But you have a way of lowering my blood pressure just by your bedside manner, by the competence and confidence that you give me. I mean, I really feel like I'm dealing with the best medical minds. And I really feel like I'm in very good hands. But just kind of focusing on what we're talking about here, I just think that one small proactive step can mean big potential benefits when you consider the possibility of never, ever developing a serious blood cancer like multiple myeloma. And that small step really is spreading the word. I want to spread the word. When I heard the statistics on how Black or African American is you know, 2 to 3 times more likely, or if you have a family member, a brother or a sister, your mother, it makes it so important for me to communicate to, and I'm putting my list together now, of all the folks that I think I can help and will, just with by providing information.
Thank you, Rob. That's wonderful. And I think maybe I'll turn it back to Courtney to see if we have questions from everyone.
Absolutely. We've received a lot of questions, and we'll get to as many as possible. So first, a question from Fred, who asked, do you have any programs working on treatment for multiple myeloma? And how can I, as a survivor of multiple myeloma, help in your efforts?
That's a great question, Fred. So we are part of the bigger myeloma program with Ken Anderson, Paul Richardson, and many others. And our myeloma therapies, as you know, have completely changed the way we think of survival in myeloma. We used to have a 3 to 5 year survival when people have active disease. Now we're up to 10, 15 years, and we have so many new drugs FDA approved, including now immunotherapy, CAR T therapy, bispecific antibodies. What I'm doing right now in the smoldering myeloma setting is we're saying, why are we waiting for people to have end organ damage and then we start all these amazing drugs? What if we bring them early? Can we cure myeloma completely by treating you early? We may not have to even invent new drugs, just bringing them earlier. So we have at least 4 or 5 clinical trials asking many questions, including immunotherapy, bringing it earlier. So when we start seeing CAR T therapy, which is making your own immune cells attack the cancer cells, or bispecific antibodies, which are also immunotherapy, we usually use them in the heavily pretreated myeloma patients after they've had so many drugs. But by definition, they have a lot of cancer cells. Their immune system is weakened because they've already had so many drugs. And of course, you don't expect those T cells to be better in that late case. So now we're actually opening studies, and finally the companies are, you know, interested in giving us the CAR Ts and the bispecifics to ask it early on, as early as smoldering myeloma, so that we can potentially use your own immune system against your cancer cells and kill them early, and you never need actual conventional chemotherapy. So we're completely changing the way we think, and hopefully that will truly get us to a cure of multiple myeloma. I can tell you there is a difference between being on therapy forever, which is sort of that chronic disease feeling with myeloma. And we would love to actually say, you got one therapy, you're done, you're cured, go on and live your life. And you don't have to be reminded constantly with that oral Revlimid or something else constantly all the time, reminding you that you have cancer.
Wonderful, thank you so much. We also received a question, is there any concern that mRNA vaccines can progress MGUS to myeloma faster than myeloma would otherwise progress?
That's a great question, especially with the COVID era and all of the vaccine questions. We started a study called the IMPACT study, which is building on PCRoD and PROMISE, asking the question, what happens to the immune system in our MGUS and smoldering myeloma patients in response to COVID infection, but also how is it responding well or not to the COVID vaccine? And as we've seen now in the news and everywhere, many people who are immunocompromised will get the third shot. And you start asking your question, well, am I immunocompromised? I have MGUS, I have smoldering myeloma. I know that people who have cancer and are on chemotherapy are immunocompromised, but what about me who has this early precursor condition? Should I just walk around and do whatever I want, or am I immunocompromised? So we are asking this question, not only looking at the antibody level after the vaccination, because we know that it may not reflect exactly all your immune system. We're taking your immune cells from the blood and doing single cell sequencing, taking every single cell and sequencing it to see how to improve on the response. And we know that even in the early MGUS stage, as early as MGUS, your immune system is not completely normal. We've done a lot of studies on that, again, with single cell sequencing. So there is a lot to understand even as early as MGUS and how to protect ourselves. We don't have any data that actually getting the vaccine will get things worse. In fact, there is no data on this, but we have the collection of 1,000 patients who participated on IMPACT to ask all those questions in it.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ghobrial. I want to acknowledge that it is 5:30 and we promised this would be a 30-minute program. We will hang on this call for a few more questions. If you have to sign off, of course, we understand and feel free to do so. So we also have received some questions about how your research, Dr. Ghobrial, might apply to other cancers.
Yeah, I think this is the first proof of concept, but we can expand this to every other cancer. In fact, that's what we're hoping to do here at Dana-Farber, that we apply this concept of early detection, early prevention to every cancer and really take it to the next level, that patients will, we will change the experience of cancer care so that we're not waiting for it to happen. We will go get it and find it early and detect it and prevent it.
Wonderful. And it's great to see so much interest in the attendees have in helping us with our efforts and even participating in the study. Who qualifies to participate in the PROMISE study?
So it's healthy participants who do not have MGUS and smoldering myeloma, but who are either African-Americans or of African origin, or if you have a first degree relative with blood cancer. These are the two criteria. Again, you can log in on promisestudy.org, see if you're eligible or not, ask us any questions. There is an email, there is contact information. You can email me anytime.
Wonderful. And we also have a question, how does the PROMISE study compare with iStop MM?
Yeah, so iStop is a great study. It's in Iceland. The PROMISE study is here in the United States. I would say the biggest part is understanding what happens here in the United States, because Iceland is a homogeneous community. The population is very similar, so it does not reflect what happens to us. We are a multiracial, multi-ethnic community, and we need to understand what happens here in the United States and how to make a difference for our own participants.
Wonderful. And we also received a related question. What is it that makes Dana-Farber uniquely positioned to run studies like the PROMISE study?
Well, I think Dana-Farber is so unique in many ways. But one thing that's amazing here is that we have the marriage of amazing science and clinical care, that we have that contribution of the discoveries that we have, the scientific technologies that we have, the amazing research that we do, and then add to it our understanding of what good clinical care is and our understanding of what patients need. And we listen to the patients. This is a continuous back and forth effort between us and the patients and the participants. And I've seen so many other centers. They're all amazing and wonderful. There's a reason why I'm still here at Dana-Farber. I think this is a very unique place.
And we have one final question. And while we cannot give medical advice for any particular individuals on this call, we did receive a question from someone who is in the IMPACT study and had COVID, a very mild form, and also has smoldering myeloma. And this person is wondering, in general, if you would recommend that people who have had COVID and have a precursor condition should get the vaccine.
So the answer, and again, please email me. And if you have any specific questions about medical care, it's important to ask us or ask your provider. In general, we think that it's important to get the vaccine. And there are specific recommendations that even though you had COVID itself, you are not completely protected. And that's what we're doing in the IMPACT study. We are looking at the immune response post-infection or post-vaccination. And although preliminary data, and we still don't have all of the data, we still see that there is an increase, there is an improvement in the immune response post-vaccination.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Ghobrial, and thank you, Robert. I also want to thank all of our participants today, especially for your active engagement and many questions. And I'd also like to express our gratitude once again to everyone who supports us in this work, our many donors who have been with us today for this event, as well as many volunteers who participate in all sorts of programs at Dana-Farber. Our faculty would not be able to conduct this groundbreaking research and deliver fantastic, compassionate care without your support. And you will see on the screen the priorities of our recently announced Dana-Farber campaign and ways that you can help the campaign. So if you were inspired, we hope, of course, you'll consider making a gift at the Dana-Farber campaign website, defycancer.org. You can also donate blood or platelets at our Kraft Family Blood Donor Center to help patients in need. We also encourage you to attend future Behind the Breakthroughs events, which you'll find listed on defycancer.org. And of course, spread the word, share our mission and our campaign to defy cancer on your social media platforms. We also encourage you to participate in Jimmy Fund fundraisers to raise support for Dana-Farber. Lastly, you will see a survey pop up in your browser when this webinar is ended. We would love to hear your thoughts on today's session. Over the past year and a half, we've hosted over 26 of these webinars, and we want to hear from you, our most loyal supporters, about what you would like us to cover in future programs. So once again, I will say thank you and a very good evening to everyone.